Go ahead and take a seat. And developing a deeper reverence is the title of this message. If you're making notes tonight, I think it's really important for us to really stop and think about some things. Sometimes you get titles of messages, and you and I'm the same as you, you know, and I don't think much of them. But everything that you'll ever do and everything you'll ever say, everything you'll ever be comes from the root of this word reverence. How much you reverence God and how well you reverence God and how long you reverence God and how much you desire to reverence God is what really determines what your future is going to be like. A lot of people don't understand that. They just think, you know, God's God, he's got my future, I don't know what I have to do anything about it. But I really believe with all my heart, God's looking for somebody, maybe it's you, that has the ability to say day after day, I really need God, I really want God, I really love God, I really respect God, to the place where that's the most important thing. I have a landscape decorator in my house. He's in this audience. And today he gave me this message. His name is Federico Martinez. He's not only my landscape decorator, I gave you a good title. You might know him as a gardener. But he's not a gardener just for our church or my home, or, if you will, my friends' churches also. Federico is my friend and has been for 20 years or more. When we first started the church, he came, and you can't help but fall in love with Adelina and Federico. Hardly spoke English when we first met each other. Adelina didn't speak any English. Now she's in all the English services, smart as can be. Wonderful family, wonderful girls. He said something to me that changed the direction of this message tonight. We were talking about my yard, and I needed some stuff done. He said, okay, Pastor, I will, because he says, you know, I love you, and you're more than just my pastor. I just love you. And I said, thank you. And he said, well, I got to go, Federico, because I got to minister tonight. And he said, I was going to stay home. He doesn't stay home. He was teasing me. He said, but I'll come. I said, oh, you'll come because you're my friend? And he says, no. He says, I'll come because I love God. Amen. And that's what just changed my whole day. Just those words when he said, I love God. I'm coming to church because I love God. I want more of God, is what he was saying. So many of you are that way, and I thank you. And so many of you are new. So many of you haven't yet experienced the depth of reverencing God to that place where he just is so important to you that everything else, you know, television, your own personal feelings, your own, you know, lifestyles, your own wants and likes and pleasures are second to him in reverencing who he is. And it's just an amazing thing when someone reverences God. I can't talk about it enough. And I said it earlier, and I'll say it again. Your future depends on how big your God is. Some people keep God little. He's just like a car, or he's something important, but he's not everything. He's in their life. They talk to him, they pray to him, but they have no passion for him or his presence. And, you know, and without the deep reverence, you'll find this woven all through the scripture. Every great man, every great woman of God ever did anything, whether it was David and everything. You'll find the failure, first king of Israel, Saul, you'll find his failure was because he did not reverence God and continue to reverence God. He started to in the beginning, but he didn't continue when things of the world started coming at him. All of a sudden, his reverence level for God got down low and became a very common thing. And so many times we start out with great reverence for God, just wanting more of God and hungering for God and just delighted in God and pleasure in God and hardly wait to get more of God, to hear something about God. Don't want to listen to that radio. radio. I want to listen to a song about God. I want to sing about God. And we start off there, and we end up, most people I've ever known in my whole life, after 40 years of ministry, I can look back and say this, most people I've ever known started off really great and hungry and found themselves in a place where God became common to them. And you cannot allow yourself ever to let God become common. Deborah and I, because we're not ministering 350 times a year like we used to a couple of years back, you know, we're now watching things happen here at this church and ministering in other churches and other places. We start off every day in a theology conversation, whether I like it or not. Sometimes I get out of bed, I didn't sleep good. I don't just feel like talking about God. But I'm married to this woman. Oh my. She is Isaiah the prophet's sister, I'm sure. I mean, it's just like everything that comes out of her is about God. And all of a sudden I find myself in these deep conversations about the depth of the things of the Lord. And an hour and a half later, man, we just had Bible college together. And all of which, my friends, helps us to maintain and develop this word reverence on the inside of all of us. Deuteronomy, the 10th chapter, verse number 12, if I could just pop it up on the overhead, it says, now Israel, what does, and I love that question, what does the Lord your God require of you but to fear the Lord your God, to walk in all of his ways and to love him, and to serve the Lord your God with all of your heart and with all of your soul. I tell you, if someone said to me as a young new Christian, what in the world does God want from me? I'm here on this planet. I mean, I'm here. I didn't ask to be here, you know, I didn't even know, but I'm here. And I believe God created the whole thing. At least I'm there. I don't know anything else. But I really want to know what God wants from me. That's all you have to do is read that verse. And he comes along and he says, makes this statement. He says, but number one, to fear the Lord your God and to walk in all of his ways and to love him. And I love this, to serve. Did you know you will never serve God until you have a depth of reverence? It is going to happen. And it's funny because in the service of God, that means doing something to build the kingdom of God. Listen to this, is when you get that reverence. It's like the guy that sits in front of the fireplace and says, give me heat and then I'll put in the wood. It doesn't work that way. If you want heat from the fireplace, you're gonna have to put the wood in first and light the wood, then you get the heat. And a lot of times we're that way with God. We're saying, God, we want to have that reverence. We want to have an awe. But, you know, sometimes you have to get in and serve God. You have to get to church. You have to make yourself do stuff until you finally get into the flow of reverencing God. And the mornings, when I get up in the morning, I want a cup of coffee. I don't want to talk about God at that moment. And all of a sudden, Isaiah the prophet's sister is at me about things of God, you know. And all of a sudden, I realize that she's a gift from God to me. She helps me to stay in there with the things of the Lord. That's not something for me to be ugly about, even though at times I don't want to talk about that right now, you know? But she doesn't matter. She just keeps talking. I don't know, it's something about women. They just keep talking, you know? And so it's been a wonderful and incredible blessing. But to serve God, I can't serve God unless I reverence God. If you really want to find somebody who's in the great service of God, it's because they really have a reverence for God. Really have a reverence for God. And then, verse number 13 is kind of an interesting verse. I really want to focus in the last three words more than anything else, but I'll read the whole thing to you. And to keep his commandments and the Lord his statutes in which he commands you today for your good. We talked about this once before. God wants you to do certain things, not for his good. He's already good. Not for his prosperity. Hello. He's already prosperous. Not for his health and healing. He's already healthy and healed. Not for his attention. He's got all the attention you could possibly ever imagine. Is that not true? not because he's some kind of an ego in the sky that needs to have the control of little people like a young boy with a magnifying glass with ants. That's not the way God is. God already has control of everything. He already has the worship of the heavens and the earth. He already has everything. Even the rocks can cry out and worship God. What this is all about, my friends, in case you didn't know this is not just about God. I want you to know something. When you reverence God, that's what it's about. But it's really about you. Why? Because these last three words, for your good. When you, look, do you ever wonder why you had kids? Someone said, oh, just to procreate the race, you know, we need to have more people planned. That's such a bunch of hogwash. You know, get spiritual once in a while. Listen to this. Do you know why you had children? So you can learn the simple process that good dads and moms take care of the children because the children don't know what they're doing. And that's exactly what God is saying. The Father in heaven knows what's good for you. And you're the child. It's exactly a scenario of heaven and you and me. And sometimes we think we've got it all. Guess what, my friends? It's for our good that everything he requires us to do. This word that gives us direction in life is not so that we could meet up or match something. He's already done that on the cross at Calvary, brought us into his family like you heard last Sunday. His spiritual DNA is ours. He's already got that. Here's what he's saying to us right now. He's saying this. He says, as you do this, you will prosper. Just like a parent says, no, it's not time for you to drive a car. You're only 7. Or get off that motorcycle when you're 3. You know, and we take care of our parents because we know, is it not true that your children always think they've got the goods on everything? They'll start, I mean, they're 4 years old, they're trying to tell you what to do and what they know. And you just laugh and think they're cute. I think that's what God looks at us and laughs and says, man, they're so cute, they don't know nothing. Isn't that cute? Let me take a picture of that one, you know? And it's like, what's this all about? It's all about the Father giving us direction because we don't know how to do life. Ever since the partaking of the tree of the knowledge of good and of evil, we do life our way instead of God's way. We now have our evaluation of things instead of God's evaluation of things. And that's why he comes along as a good parent and he does what? For our good, he takes us and he's patient with us, loves us, directs us, even puts it in writing so that you can't miss it. For our good. Somebody say amen. Amen. Okay, look, real quick. I don't know if we're going to do this. I don't know if they have it up on the overhead, but it was foundations. I forgot to tell them to put this up. But if you want to make a notice, foundations for reverence, or foundations of reverence. There are a lot of things God tells us to reverence, doesn't he? Number one, like your parents. I mean, that's cool. Reverence your parents. Respect your parents. Have, what do you have if you get that? If you do that, you get long life out of that. Reverence his name. I like that one. You know, there's a lot of things God tells us to reverence. But there's some things he's really looking for when we do reverence something. He says reverence, and I love this one. It's one of my favorite. Reverence the elderly. Oh, let me try this side over here because you guys missed it completely. How about a little clap on that one? Reverence the elderly. Thank you. And so, you know, here, I like that. There's a lot of things to reverence, you know, all kinds of things. Reverence each other, respect each other, all that kind of stuff. It tells us scripture, but I found 4 that are very important that God looks for in every single one of us. And we can work on all 4 of these. Number one. Here's the first thing on the foundation, if you will. Foundations of reverence. Number one, reverence God is number one. See, you respect a lot of things. Have you ever stopped and thought about what are the things you respect? You respect other people that have achieved things. You respect position. You really respect people with lots of money. I mean, whole countries chasing after people with money right now. And you really, if you stop and you think about what are some of the things we respect accomplishment, we respect people who write books, we respect the educated, For some people, we respect the color of our car. We're reverencing the make of our car, the motor size of our automobiles. We reverence, you know, our bosses, maybe in some cases, because they've achieved something. We're always reverencing something. And oftentimes what we do in our life is we reverence things and we put them aside God. Like they're very important. Like I really reverence my time on vacation. Man, nobody's gonna mess with my time on vacation. When I find myself in a place of realizing that I can't put a priority on that. My priority has got to be in God as number one. And for most of you, you don't have a problem with this. This is just like baby talk 101. I understand that. But in order for you to keep going and have him as a priority, a lot of things try to creep into your life. Have you ever noticed? I mean, all of a sudden somebody is turned on to God and she's a single woman in church and meets a man. And it is, oh, he's a Christian guy. Well, he's a brand new Christian guy. And all of a sudden she's not in church anymore, neither is he. All of a sudden what happened? The priority got out of sync. People who get a lot of money all of a sudden that were great Christians get a lot of money, all of a sudden the priority changes, and all of a sudden instead of God being first and holding him first no matter what comes our way, good, bad, or indifferent, we don't do that. What we do is that comes in and it slides in every day. There's a penetration of something that becomes priority to us. And we spend more time, if all you have to do is look at your checkbook and see what's priority in you, by how much you spend on other things instead of things that should be spent on. And so we've got to work at this all the time. The neat thing about Federico Martinez was that when he made that statement to me, I knew already that there was a priority in his life. It wasn't my garden and it wasn't my house. It wasn't the church and the churches that he does, that in gardening and all those things. The things that was important about Federico was there was a priority. Priority was, man, I have worked and labored in the hot sun all day long with people. I've done all the work nobody else wants to do or desires to do. And I'm going to go home. I'm going to shower and I want to lay down and I want to just take a nap and I just want to eat Adelina's food and just put my feet up and just rest. And, oh no, he gets dressed and he comes to church. Let me tell you something. That's maintaining the priority of reverence. And we've got to maintain the priority of reverence. And one of the things I told our pastors, because they're all incredibly brilliant, you know, I told Pastor Paul, I told Pastor Dan, I told Pastor Luke, the problem they're going to have is not the transition. That's not the problem. The problem they're going to have is not the acceptance of people. That's not a problem. Their problem is going to come when success is piled on them. Then will they maintain the priority of reverence when things are so good and the numbers of people are all over. And everybody thinks you're wonderful and there's no problems. And all of a sudden you're the, you know, promoted self guru, which people do. And in that success, more people fail than you can possibly imagine. And so here's Grandpa really keeping before them. You've got to maintain that God is first. There's nothing else more important than God is first. That's the most important thing. You don't breathe air without God giving it to you. You don't have a beat of a heart without God. This has got to be a God thing. You got to realize every place you go, whatever you say, whatever you do, it's got to be a God thing. And that's why I want to take you to Joshua, the 24th chapter, if I may get you there real quick. In Joshua 24, let's just try to move as fast as we can. Is that okay? In Joshua 24. And, you know, these guys, because they're so doggone good, they're going to be, I mean, I'm in other countries, and they're talking to me about getting them to come to these countries and preach these conferences. And I'm going, absolutely, they're fabulous. They won't find anybody better. And I'm thinking, guy, you gotta be kidding. You know, like you're 30 years old. Well, you better have your head on straight or this whole thing will blow up in your face. That's my job. And that's my job with you, is to make sure that reverence is maintained him as first, because everything will try to get him out of first place. Are you listening to me? Oh, you'll still say, I love God. I love God. Sure you love God. Nothing to do with whether you love God or don't love God. Of course you love God. It isn't about loving God. It's about how much you reverence God. Someone says, oh my goodness, I don't have to go to church. You know, I still love God. God still loves me. Absolutely. But do you reverence him enough to serve him? Is anybody listening? Because it's good. You got to hear that. So here's the important thing. In Joshua 24, 14, it says these words. Now, therefore, fear the Lord, serve him, remember we talked about, in sincere and in truth, and put away the gods of which your father served on the other side of the river and in Egypt. Serve the Lord. All of a sudden, we see something. We say, oh, that's not for us. That's the fathers that were on the other side of Egypt. No. Do you know what he just said? Get out of what your parents used to do. Get out of what the world is doing. And the gods they serve. Don't tell me some of the politicians who call themselves Christians. Can I tell you something? Don't tell me politics is not more important than God to them. Their God is politics or their God is money. It is not God. Are you following me? And you're going to see that right before your very eye. Don't let that be you. If you're going to serve God, you're going to have to understand, you're going to have to serve God. That's great. He wants you to serve God. Make sure you leave all the old stuff behind. Keep going on forward. Push yourself forward. And it's so important for us to see. In Matthew, the 10th chapter, go there with me in verse number 28. We're talking about reverencing God and keeping him first. Matthew, the 10th chapter, verse 28. I'm going to just buzz through some of these verses tonight because they're really good for you and good for me to hear too because I love hearing it over and over again. And here's Jesus speaking. How many love to hear Jesus speak? And watch this, what he says. Here he talks about who to reverence, who to respect. Do not fear those who kill the body but cannot kill the soul. Is that an interesting comment? But rather fear him who is able to destroy both the soul and the body in hell. You know what he just said? Don't fear anybody. Except me. I'm the only one can destroy it all and send you to hell. No devil can destroy it. No devil can destroy you. No devil can curse you. You cannot curse what is blessed. He can only get you to curse yourself. And that's what a lot of Christians do. They curse themselves. And they stay cursed through some situation. You are not a cursed people. You are a blessed people. And you cannot be cursed. And he says, why do you fear the devil? He can't destroy you and send you to hell. There's no fear there. Who you need to put your respect level on fear is me. Because I could do all of that. My goodness, put him first, keep him first, and fight to keep him first. Because everything's going to try to come in, everything. Family's going to try to come in, kids going to come in, money's going to come in, the boss is going to try to come in, relatives are going to try to come in. Everything's going to try to get you off base. But keep God number one first. Somebody say amen. Second thing, let's learn. We're talking about foundations of reverence. Number two, reverence the house of God. And I love this. Reverence the house of God. You know, when I'm in the back door greeting people, all these years, you know, I don't know how many, almost 30 years in the back door greeting people. You know, and I please forgive me. So many people go to this church 10, 12 years. I don't know your name. You know my name because I'm in front. But, you know, I tried to learn everybody's name. And finally I went to God and said, God, I just can't learn everybody's name. It's driving me nuts. I can't even learn the word, let alone learn everybody's name. God says, forget their name. Just know my name. And I said, okay, that sounds good to me. So people come up to me all the time in the back door and say, you know, I've been coming to this church for 12 years. Do you know my name? No. But I know someone who does. His name is Jesus. In fact, then I say it this way. In fact, I know two people. They say, you do? Pastor Dan. I mean, he knows everybody's name. It's like, how do you do that? It's just such a gift God's given him to know everybody's name. I don't know everybody's name. I know my name. I know Debbie's. I know Pastor Dan. And the rest of you, I'm not sure about. And here's the deal. Every now and then, I'll get somebody at the back door, and they just came to the church for the first time. And they stop me and they say, look, you know what you need to do? You need to do and I just, you know, at first I was just really ugly. You know, I mean, I just really got ugly. Then I found a verse. This is my favorite verse for those people. The problem with it is every time I give it to them, none of them ever come back. But I feel so good because it shuts them right up. Does anybody know what I'm talking about? And so I you know, I just feel so good. Here's the verse, Ecclesiastes 5:1. Go there with me. You go to the book of Proverbs, the book right behind Proverbs, you're going to find Ecclesiastes. If you go to Proverbs and you're going forward to Psalms, you're going the wrong way. Proverbs, right behind Proverbs, is Ecclesiastes. When you get to Ecclesiastes, get to the 5th chapter. And here's the verse I said to them. Every time I get somebody ugly in my face, I say this verse. Why? Because it's important. Remember what we're talking about, reverence of the house of God. Right? Reverence the house of God. If you don't reverence the house of God, then what are you going to do? You're going to complain. You're going to make suggestions. You're going to listen. If you're looking for perfect pastors, his name is Jesus. The rest of us are doing the best job we can. And man, sometimes we mess up and sometimes we're just flat old humans. Does anybody know what I'm talking about? And anybody that tries to pretend like they're not, like they're so spiritual and never make a mistake, they're a liar and you need to get out of that church. Because we're all here doing the best we can, you, us, everybody. And we need to respect the house of God where we gather together, we hear the word of God, we learn something about us and about God. But here's my verse that just shuts them right up. Are you ready? Verse number one, I'll read it to you. Walk prudently. When you go into the house of God and draw near to hear, rather than to give the sacrifice of fools, that means your opinion, for they do not know that they do evil. And I'll read that. I said, you want me to read that to you again? I never have seen one of those people come back. So I'm so happy that Pastor Dan is now in control because he's a good guy. He would not quote that. But my point being here is this. We need to reverence the house of God. Oh, I love that verse. Sorry, if it's sin, it's sin. John, the 2nd chapter, verse 16 says this. And he said to those, this is Jesus speaking, because he's mad. He's been in the temple. They're selling all kinds of goods in the temple that is just really aggravating him. Can I tell you the story, how it goes? You know how it is. He makes a whip and he runs everybody out and he really makes a comment about how bad they are because they made a place of merchandise or selling the house of God short. And a lot of times people don't understand that. So they come to us, they say, you know, you got a bookstore that's ungodly, you know, and you got a restaurant that feeds people that's so ungodly because you're only out for money. You know, you made your house. But here's, you got to understand this. What it was is thousands of people would pilgrimage into Jerusalem from all over the Eastern world, from everywhere, Europe, everywhere. They come into Jerusalem by thousands. They couldn't bring their sacrifice to the temple. They couldn't bring even a little dove. It wouldn't last. They couldn't bring their sheep. They couldn't bring their oxen. So when they got to the temple, for thousands of years before Jesus, they would literally buy something there at the temple. And it was like crazy. They were selling stuff for 10 or 15 times what it should be sold for. You know, it would cost everything just to get a little dove to offer as a sacrifice. It would cost a lamb or a sheep. It cost everything. And it wasn't the selling of stuff that was bad because that had been going on for years. And Jesus knew it and grew up in that. Here's what was bad. What was bad was they were taking advantage of the condition of the people and the situation of the people and literally raping them for their economics. And Jesus gets mad and he ties a whip up, if you remember, and he just goes through the place and he makes this statement. And remember, we're talking about reverencing the house of God. Listen closely. Here's the statement. And he says, and he said to those who sold doves, take these things away. Do not make my father's house a house of merchandise. In other words, Jesus had a respect for the house of God. When we come into this house of God, yes, it's different. Yes, it's got big screens and smoke and lights. That's only the attraction. It's like the bait that gets people to come to experience something, and the Word of God does the rest. The Word of God in this house has never changed and never will change. How we get the Word of God into the different generations will change. And that's what this is all about. You got to respect and reverence the house of God, number two. Is that all right? And real quick, number three, let me just go there, number three, and then we'll finish up here in just a moment. Number three, reverence your spiritual leader. Look, I'm putting this up on the overhead, but do you see what's important isn't just the word reverence and the word spiritual leader. Let me say something. If you're a person without a leader, you're a sheep without a shepherd. And Jesus really talks about that. And the word is that he wept over Jerusalem because they did not have somebody to help them stay on course. You know, the Lord is my shepherd and I shall not want, the Bible says. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. You know, and we need a shepherd. Yes, his name is Jesus, but Jesus actually works through people. And I agree that there are some people that call themselves shepherds that are not very good shepherds. But for every one that is not a good shepherd, there's 1,000 that are good shepherds. You know, and I hate that when they pollute all of the shepherds and they put them in one lump sum that everybody's bad because somebody went bad, somebody went wrong, someone was a bad apple. It doesn't work that way with God. And here it says reverence. In other words, if I don't respect somebody, how can I ever learn from them? How will I ever hear? I reverence Debbie. And when she talks, may I say something, my friend? I listen. Sometimes I don't, but I always listen. Sometimes she says, you're not listening. I said, I am listening, honey. I'm listening. I'm listening. Why? Because I respect her. I reverence her. I love her. She's not my Jesus. She's not my Holy Spirit. She's not even close to them. But she's someone I respect. You have people you respect and you listen to them. If you do not respect them, you won't listen. So the biggest word up there is the word your. See it? See the word your? That's why I put that there. Until you make the leadership, if this is your church, your spiritual leader. And listen, and stop expecting them to be perfect. And stop getting all bent out of shape because someone walks by you without saying hi. Or stop saying, he doesn't even know my name after 147 years of being here. Forget that part. Look for the part that gets God on the inside of you. That's what you need to do. Because this is about your leader. This is about your church. This is about your God. And that's what we talked about, your God, your church, your leader. And until you get to that place, you're going to find yourself criticizing, judging, and all that stuff and never get anything. Bible says the ones that flourish are the ones that are planted in the house of God. Flourishing means, man, you're producing even in a time of trouble, even when things aren't going good. Did you know during the recession, we had great growth? During the times when Bill Clinton shut down the Air Force base here, and all of a sudden we lost 50% of our church. 50% was gone, they moved, and then the people that were at the Air Force base, all the businesses around, they all moved too. San Bernardino became a ghost town. Did you know what happened to the Rock Church? It kept growing. Because it's not about it's about God. And it's about the people that were here, respected as leaders, they were going to get something from God and go forward with God. And can I say something to you? This is a healthy place. And if you don't think it is, you better go find out something. It's a healthy place. And you know, you fight for that. Hebrews, the 13th chapter, verse number 7, says it like this. I love these words. Hebrews, 13th chapter, verse 7. Turn there with me. Hebrews 13 says, remember those who rule over you. Now, who's that? We're talking about spiritually now. Remember those who rule over you. How? Spiritually. Who have spoken the word of God to you. Who's that? Can I just say something? You can have a rotten spiritual leader that's no good. You don't have that here, but if you did, and he spoke a word to you, did you know God will fulfill his word in you? Not based on him, but based on who you are and based on the character and attributes of his word. So you can have a lousy leader and say, I hate leaders. It's not about the leader. It's about what God does through the leader to you. It's about you. And he makes this, listen to this. He was spoken the word of God to you, whose faith follow, considering the outcome of their conduct. In other words, they make sure you stay on course. So here we find ourselves tonight in this place. We're talking about foundations of reverence, things to reverence. Without a great reverence, you're never going to go to great places. Without a great reverence, you're never going to do great things. Oh, listen to me. Without a great reverence, you're never going to be what you could be. Without a great reverence, my friends, listen to me. You will never become what God wants you to become. Without a great reverence, you'll never have what you could have had. Every one of us need to work on it. Here's number four. Reverence for his word. Very important for us. Reverence for God's word. In other words, he loves us and it's about taking care of us as a good father takes care of his children. He gave it to us in writing. We're no longer waiting for the prophet to come to town to tell us what God says or thinks. We now have it in our lap. It's a done deal. You'll never get anything out of it until you reverence what it says, until you respect it. Deborah and I have this phenomenal marriage. I'm more in love with Mama now than I've ever been in my life. I could hardly keep my eyes off of her. I'm in love with her. I chase her all the time. Sometimes she lets me catch her. I'm so old, I don't remember what to do. But nevertheless, I catch her. And I'm nuts about her. I mean, can you imagine a grandpa in love with grandma? That's a pretty cool thing. Yeah? You know, that's a pretty cool thing. Let me tell you something. It didn't happen just because we met opposites attract. We ain't opposite. We're two peas in a pod. What she likes, I like. What she doesn't like, I don't like. She likes to talk, I like to talk. She likes to talk, I learned how to listen. She likes to buy, I give her the money. This is a great relationship. My point being is this. It happened because I found out how through the word of God to have a great marriage. My friends, you don't know this, but before I was 25 years old, I was thrown out 3 times and divorced 3 times. Brokenhearted, wanting to die, I went into a church and I told them I just went through a third divorce I didn't want. 25 years old, the church threw me out. I wanted to die. I found out that if I could just do things not my way, not my father's way, even though he was a good father and a good husband, not my mother's way, not what everybody else was doing, but I found out what the Word of God was doing. How do I treat my wife when she ticks me off? Don't think for a moment two people that are exactly the same and powerful personalities can get up in each other's face. But how do you back off and do a God thing? How do you love each other? How do you care and promote each other? How do you build each other? I found out in the Word of God found out how to love God, found out how to reverence God, found out how to serve God, found out all these things, all by the word of the Lord, until you have a reverence for the word of God. Do you know, we don't have church to laugh and have fun. Even though we do, but we don't have church just to have a little game and a show, even though there's a lot of games and shows and fun. We have church, and every time you come to church, someone's telling you about something. It's not their own personal experience. It's the word of God that makes the difference in people's lives. You want to know why all of my children are serving God and preaching the gospel? All of them. And my grandchildren, I have 12 grandchildren and one great-grandchild that are getting ready to preach the gospel. They're in college getting ready to preach the gospel all over the world. You know why? It's because I found out what it said in the word, and Deborah and I did the word of God. And you'll never have anything until you realize, my friends, his word is truth. No other truth, but his word is truth. It's what I love about the Rock Church. And I love these words, Psalms 119, 105. Just pop it up on the overhead. Everybody ought to memorize this. This is your homework for the week. It's about 14 words, simple. Here it is, 14 words to memorize. Your word is a lamp to my feet and a light to my path. You want to know how to get there? You got to see your way. And you want to know what path to take so you end up at the right place? It's his word. Until you reverence the word, it won't work. Four things tonight. Number one, you got to remember and fight for God being first. Let's put that back up. Number two, you're going to have to do something really very special too, because you're going to have to really reverence the house of God. And number three, we talked about this. You're going to have to reverence your spiritual leaders. And number four, you're going to have to do this. Listen to this, reverence for God's word. So don't ever let it stop. Boy, I tell you what, you know, now that I'm retired, I think sometimes I don't have to do anything. You know what I have to do? I got to get closer to God and reverence him more and more and more. If God spoke to you tonight, come on, give the Lord a great big praise. Isn't God good?